Hello, welcome to Byte Size Med. This video is a compilation of a bunch of recall cards that I've created on cardiac embryology and fetal circulation. I've put together 9 quizzes and each is 1 minute long. If you'd like to do them at random, you can check out my playlist linked in the description box below. But for this video, press pause when I tell you to and try and recall as much as you can. We'll start off with a very straightforward one. The heart develops from the heart tube. All you gotta do is name the parts of that tube. And what's the direction of blood flow through this tube? You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need to recall what you know about this structure. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. The heart tube has a cranial end, which is the arterial end, and a caudal end, which is venous. From above down, we have the truncus arteriosus, which is the distal third of the bulbous cordis. It leads into the aortic sac and the aortic root. Then we have the primitive ventricle, the primitive atrium, and the sinus venosus with its right and left horns. Just like in the developed heart, blood enters through the venous end and out through the arteriole. So in the tube, blood enters through the sinus venosus, goes through the primitive atrium, the primitive ventricle, the bulbous cordis, the truncus arteriosus, and then gets pumped out through the arterial end. That's the heart tube. Now we look at the chambers of the heart. The right and left atria develop from the heart tube. Your task is to recall which parts of that tube form the right atrium and which parts form the left. You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. The atria have rough anterior walls, the trabeculated parts, and the smooth posterior walls. The trabeculated portions of both atria come from the primitive atrium of the heart tube, but the smooth posterior portions differ. In the right atrium, it's formed by the right horn of the sinus venosus, that's called the sinus venarum, and in the left atrium, it's formed by the absorption of pulmonary veins. That's where the atria come from. Done with the atria, we move on to the ventricles. The ventricles develop from the heart tube. Your task is to recall which parts of the heart tube form the right and left ventricles. The two are separated by a septum. Name the two parts of that septum. You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. The ventricles have a trabeculated or rough inflow portions and smooth outflow tracts. That's the infundibulum on the right and the aortic vestibule on the left. These smooth parts come from the middle third of the bulbous cordis, also called the conus cordis. The proximal third of the bulbous cordis forms the rough trabeculated part of the right ventricle, while the primitive ventricle forms the trabeculated part of the left ventricle. The interventricular septum separates the two, and it has a membranous part above and a muscular part below. Now the big vessels of the heart. The heart has two ventricles, right and left. From these chambers, two big vessels emerge. Let's start easy. Your task is to recall the names of these two vessels. Now let's make it a little harder. Which embryological structure do they come from? Name the structure that separates them into two vessels. And if that separating structure doesn't form, what would happen? You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. Pulmonary trunk emerges from the right ventricle, the ascending aorta from the left ventricle. They form from the truncus arteriosus, which is a part of the heart tube. It's a single vessel which gets separated by a spiral aortico-pulmonary septum. And if that doesn't form, it'll stay a single vessel. That condition is called a persistent truncus arteriosus. Sounds very similar to patent ductus arteriosus, but the two are completely different. Next up, we've got fetal circulation. In fetal life, there are shunts in circulation. They are normally present. One of those shunts is between the pulmonary artery and the aorta. Your task is to recall what that shunt is called. Which way does blood flow through the shunt during fetal life? After birth, it closes. What does it form then? And if it stays open, what's that condition called? You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need for recall. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. This is a duct between two big vessels, the ductus arteriosus, which during fetal life shunts blood from the pulmonary artery to the aorta, that's right to left, bypassing the lungs. After birth, it closes, and its remnant is called the ligamentum arteriosum. It should close, but if it stays open, it's patent, and that condition is called a patent ductus arteriosus. Now we'll add in a little anatomy to the embryology. The heart is supplied by arteries and drained by veins, just like the other organs in the body. Your task is to recall the names of the three main veins that drain blood from the walls of the heart. They empty into a structure. What's it called? What's that structure's embryological origin? And which chamber of the heart does it empty into? You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. There are three main veins draining the heart: the great, middle, and the small cardiac veins. They empty into the coronary sinus, which is located in the coronary sulcus. The coronary sinus is derived from the left horn of the sinus venosus, and it empties into the right atrium. Back to those shunts in foetal circulation. When the atria of the heart develop, they split with an interatrial septum. There's a space in that septum. Your task is to recall what that opening is called. Which way does blood flow through this opening? Right to left or left to right? The opening closes after birth. What's it called then? And if it doesn't close, what's that called? You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need for recall. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. This opening between the right and left atria is called the oval foramen or the foramen ovale, and it's normal during fetal life because blood gets shunted from the right to the left atrium. But this shunt has to close after birth, and it does, forming a depression called the oval fossa or the fossa ovalis. If this space remains open, it's patent, and that condition is called patent foramen ovale. This next one is on fetal blood vessels. During fetal life, there are umbilical arteries and veins. Your task is to recall how many umbilical arteries are there and how many umbilical veins. Do they carry oxygenated or deoxygenated blood towards the heart or away from it? And after birth, what do they become? You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. During fetal life, the placenta does the job of oxygenating blood. Two umbilical arteries carry deoxygenated blood away from the heart and towards the placenta. After oxygenation, the oxygenated blood is carried by a single umbilical vein away from the placenta and towards the heart. After birth, no more placenta. The remnant of the umbilical arteries is the medial umbilical ligament, and the umbilical vein is the ligamentum teres in the liver. This last one is on a congenital heart disease. During cardiac development, sometimes things can go wrong, resulting in congenital heart disease. One of those is a famous combination of four things, the Tetralogy of Fallot. Your task is simple. Recall the four components of this tetralogy. You can pause the video here and take as much time as you need for recall. But I just get 1 minute, so time's up. The Tetralogy of Fallot. Let's do this anti-clockwise. We'll start with the ventricular septum. There's a hole. That's a ventricular septal defect. Above that, the aorta emerges, making it an overriding aorta. There's obstruction of right ventricular outflow, pulmonary stenosis, and the right ventricle, it hypertrophies. Ventricular septal defect, overriding aorta, pulmonary stenosis, and right ventricular hypertrophy. That's the tetralogy of Fallot. That's all I've got for now, but a couple of things that can help you out while studying cardiac embryology. If you do make notes, use colors. It makes it easier to remember the derivatives if you keep looking at the same color every time you glance at it. Make sure you know anatomy before attempting to study embryology. I think that's the case with all organs. It's only if you know the final picture that you can sort of piece together how to get there, where each part comes from. If you know your destination, it becomes easier to get there. Lastly, build on what you learn. Make sure you've understood how the heart develops first before attempting to learn congenital heart disease. Make things easier for yourself by spending a little time to get your basics right so you can build from there. Add in the defects and figure out what went wrong for that to happen. And keep going. Add in pathophysiology, clinical features, etc. One step at a time. Build slow and build strong. I hope these recall cards were helpful. If they were, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Leave me a comment if you'd want more on other topics that I made videos on. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.